Thank you very much for being a part of the program. Let's start with June 12. Today is June 12, and some time ago Nigerians came out en masse to vote, and that was when the story about June 12 started. What do you think about this whole story around June 12 and the NKO umbrella?
Well, it's not just a story, it's history, it's reality. It's something that Nigerians, I don't think, appreciate enough. That is the fact that this great man made such a great sacrifice. Had it not been for MK Abiola and his struggle and that of all those that followed him and supported him, we wouldn't have democracy today. And a lot of young people don't know this. But the facts are that this was a man that won an election, the freest and fairest election in the history of our country, June 12th, 1993, I think, 24 years ago or so. He came in, he won the election, and the election was annulled. Not only was the election annulled, shortly thereafter, about a year or so later, he was arrested and by the military authorities, and he was detained for a number of years. After the detention, before I even get there, his wife was murdered whilst he was in detention. And so were many, many hundreds, if not thousands of his followers, were murdered from all over the country, but particularly in the Southwest. By 1998, they now decided to murder this man because he refused to relinquish his mandate. He was approached by the Secretary General of the Commonwealth at the time and by the Secretary General of the United Nations at the time, who he didn't even know because he had been in detention for so long he couldn't read newspapers, and they urged him to relinquish the mandate and to come back home. And this man refused to do so. The Americans approached him as well. And upon his refusal and his reluctance to relinquish his mandate, there was a conspiracy, and this man was murdered. And how was he murdered? He was given tea. They call it Abuja tea. And he was given the tea by the lady that was President Obama's national security advisor, Susan Rice. It's a matter of historical record. I've put this question to the lady herself in the past, and she never answered the question. Pickering, who the American ambassador Pickering was there at the time. They were all there. They all witnessed it. She prepared the tea, handed the tea to him. He drank the tea, started coughing, and the next thing he dropped dead right there in front of them. These are the historical facts. And of course, Abacha had been dispatched shortly before that time. Abiola too was also dispatched. And that paved the way to bring Obasanjo out of prison. And then he was now elected president of the country in 1999 in order to appease Abiola's primary constituency, which was the Southwest.
So how do we now marry this whole issue with the Nigerian democracy for over 18 years now?
Had it not been for that single event, that is the June 12th struggle, which was essentially the struggle against military rule and military government. Had it not been that that struggle was sustained from 1993, June 12th, up until 1999, to the extent that the country almost broke up in 1999. Had it not been for the fact they brought Obasanjo, who happened to be a Yoruba man, to lead this country, we wouldn't have Nigeria today as one country because it would have broken up, or we wouldn't have had democracy today and military rule would have continued and many people would have been slaughtered. So, like I said earlier, he lost his wife. Thousands of his supporters were killed. Many were driven into exile, including yours truly. I was in exile as well. And we had our great leaders like Baba Adesanya, Abraham Adesanya, Baba Ayo Adesanya, Adebanjo, who is still very much alive today, Professor Wole Soyinka, Bola Tinubu, you know, and when he was really, these were the leaders of NADECO. These were our leaders at that time. And they still are, you know, to a great extent. The sacrifices all these people made, Baguda Kalto, a journalist like you who was murdered, so many people were bombed, so many people were killed. The military were absolutely vicious. It's not like today. The slightest thing you say, they'll come and kill you in your house. They'll bomb you, bomb your family, and so on and so forth. And this is what we faced. This is what they faced. And but Abiola refused to relinquish the mandate, rightly so, and they ended up murdering him. He was a martyr. A great hero of democracy. He sacrificed his life for Nigeria. He sacrificed his wife for Nigeria. All those people that died were sacrifices, and they made great sacrifices, and we need to honor them. And today really is the true Democracy Day, and not May 29th, as far as I'm concerned.
But it was, you are a PDP member now. It was the PDP that actually brought this.
You're absolutely right. Well, maybe that's why we're paying the price now. No, but... I'm just joking. No, but the issue is that, well, that was purely the decision of the administration at that time, of which I was a proud member. But unfortunately, it was not Femi Fanikaidi's government. Yes. It was President Olusegun Obasanjo's government. And you know, you have to understand also, there was a lot of people that were opposed to the whole Abiola thing. Within the military complex of Nigeria, the power configuration of the country. It was them against us, if you like. And even though, in my view, Obasanjo, President Obasanjo, a man I have great respect and affection for, and will always do, was, in my view, probably the greatest beneficiary of the June 12th struggle, I think his own view was that you needed to carry both sides along. So let's not upset one side by declaring June 12th, but in my view, and this is my subjective view, I believe that that was in error, that the real Democracy Day is June 12th, and we ought to honor this day. We ought to honor Abiola. We ought to honor Abiola's family, and we ought to honor all those that died in that struggle from all over the country, not just the Southwest, all over the country that stood for democracy, that fought for democracy, and that died for democracy.
Are you not surprised that the people in power today, most of the close to about 60 to 70% of political office holders in APC today, were those who actually clamored and fought for the June 12th? But today they seem not to be talking about June 12th.
Well, I would probably disagree with you there. In the Southwest, yes. In the Southwest, not just those in the APC, I think every Yoruba man, really. I mean, I cannot remember or think of one Yoruba man, whether you're PDP or APC, that did not stand for June 12th. We really fought that battle at that time. Most of our leaders were out of the country. They were arresting our elders. They were arresting people like Baba Adesanya, Adebanjo, so on and so forth, and subjecting them to all kinds of humiliation. And they tried to murder them on a number of occasions. So every Yoruba man, whether PDP, APC, or non-aligned, if you like, and even extra-political, and people that aren't even interested in politics. It was a struggle, and we were all on the same side. But if you look at the APC today, the APC, the constituent part of the APC from the north, led by President Buhari and all those that stand with him, 99% of them were completely and utterly against Abiola and against June 12th. In fact, it could be argued, and I'm speaking to you as a historian now, it could be argued that they're the very same people that insisted that the mandate that Abiola won fairly and squarely should not be given to him. And they insisted that, you know, something needed to be done about him if he wasn't prepared to relinquish the mandate. And of course, that thing was done. He was murdered. In my view, it could be argued that these same people we're talking about now, that is the northern elements within the APC, were the very same people that took that position. And of course, in my view, many of them are taking that position even today, that a southerner is just not good enough to be president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria.
Now, if you have this view, how come Abiola won so many hearts, even from every region in Nigeria then?
That's a very good question. My view is as a consequence of the things that happened post-June 12th. Up until that time, I was a Federalist, very close. My father fought on the side of, was aligned to the North, let me put it like that, throughout his political career, and a very distinguished one it was. And my family has always been associated with the North, politically, for many, many years. But June 12th, for us, those of us from the Southwest, changed everything in this country. And that's when we started questioning certain things. Abiola was the closest Yoruba man to the North. He was a good Muslim. He helped churches. He built mosques. He built churches. He did everything. He was a quintessential Nigerian. He had as much support in Kano and in the North as he did in the South. Okay. He was a great man, a very wealthy, powerful man, and a very kind-hearted man. He was the perfect gentleman.
And that was why he won the votes.
Won votes all over the country. Yes. But a certain group within the power configuration of the country, who believed that they were essentially born to rule and who were not prepared to hand over power to such a man, took the decision and the election was annulled. This is what happened. And you also have to look at it, that the military configuration at the time as well, for one reason or the other, and I can go into that if you like, didn't want Abiola because they probably felt that he's the one person that knew how to put them in their place if he was given power. These are my views, and this is the historical reality. This is what actually happened. And like I said earlier, we still have elements within our political class today that still have those tendencies. They're not as strong as they used to be. And thank goodness the rest of the country has pulled together and we're fighting those ultra-conservative elements that have this very mundane and retrograde attitude and views about our politics in this country.
In 2019, Nigeria will be going to the polls. Do you think we can still have a man like Abiola that a lot of persons will want to rule this country?
Well, I sincerely hope so. But the Nigeria of 2017 is very different to the Nigeria of 1993. Mm-hmm. We were far more cohesive in 1993, pre the annulment. We were more or less a united country, even though we had a lot of issues at the time. But the country was more or less united. Nobody at that time thought of secession or thought of that it was a fundamental, the issues we have today, religious crisis, the agitation for self-determination, all kinds of divisions within our country. We didn't have that at that time. They started, we'd had it earlier in the 60s. We fought a civil war over it. But between the time that the civil war ended up until, let's say, the early 90s, Nigeria was more or less cohesive. We may have had issues, but we were cohesive and nobody spoke about breaking the country up. Post June 12th, there were great agitations to break this country. If Abacha had succeeded himself successfully, I assure you the Yorubas would have broken off from Nigeria. We were all involved in that agitation at the time. Even from abroad, we were bringing in arms into this country. We were planning to secede and lead an armed struggle against Abacha's government. And the Americans knew this, which is why they now had to intervene covertly and tell Babangida and all the others that were like behind the scenes that, look, something needed to be done about Abacha. Abacha was taken out. And they now said to balance the equation. And those were their words, not mine. That is what they said at the time. To balance the equation, Abiola had to be taken out as well in order to ensure that the two tendencies, the two sides, don't break Nigeria up. And that's how they brought President Obasanjo out from prison and made him the president. And he was the perfect candidate to ensure that there was, once again, national cohesion. And there was cohesion after Obasanjo from 1919 and up until 2007. Then came Yar'Adua. Then came Jonathan. Though those elements tried to rock Obasanjo's world when he started... when he refused to do their bidding, then they now brought out political Sharia. He survived it. Eventually, Yar'Adua came in, then came Jonathan. Jonathan refused to do their bidding, or rather, let me put it like this. Jonathan did everything that they wanted him to do, but it still wasn't enough. And they now rocked his world with Boko Haram and eventually pushed him out of power, primarily as a consequence of the whole Boko Haram agitation, the whole Boko Haram war, and what they perceived to be his handling of that war. And they misinterpreted him and maligned him before the international community. That's how they got him out of power. In comes Buhari. Buhari has come into power in this country. He's been in power for 2 years. We are more divided than we have ever been since the Civil War. In terms of religion, in terms of region, in terms of ethnicity. The cry for self-determination, which is a cry that cannot be resisted successfully in perpetuity. Eventually it'll manifest. Is greater today than it was even pre the Civil War.
What is responsible for that? If we had a kind of a cohesion.
What's responsible for that is primarily the policies of this particular government. A situation whereby every single security agency in this country, apart from the Navy, is headed by a northern Muslim is unacceptable. A situation whereby every single commander in the Nigerian army today that has the power to deploy troops, strategic commanders, not ordinary commanders, they are all northern Muslims. A situation whereby Igbos are being threatened and told to leave the northern part of the country. Otherwise, they'll be murdered and killed by October the 1st. And they will now, what happened during the pogroms in 1966 will now be revisited where they will lose everything, including their lives. That is what leads to this sort of thing.
Isn't that history is...
A situation whereby IPOB, the young IPOB, yeah. Are being slaughtered morning, day and night by our security forces. A situation whereby Shiite Muslims are slaughtered and genocide is committed and nothing happens. A situation whereby Fulani herdsmen are going all over the country, both north and south, targeting primarily Christians and slaughtering them as if there's no tomorrow. 808 Christians were slaughtered in southern Kaduna last Christmas, between Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. 808. And this goes on morning, day, and night. I can name Agatu, Abia State, all over the country. These people are operating, and none of them have been arrested. Meanwhile, women, children, defenseless old men are being slaughtered in their homes by these people. Nothing's up. That is what has led to this division. That is what has led to this crisis. And it really is a crisis. And, you know, I knew that this is what the APC would do. Unfortunately, people didn't accept that argument at the time. Now we're seeing it. A situation whereby, you know, 2.1 million people lost their jobs in 2016. A situation whereby the churches and Christian leaders are being treated with contempt. Up until today, the president of Canada has not been able to see the president of Nigeria. Not only that, he hasn't been able to see the acting president of Nigeria. They've refused to see him. And the acting president is a Christian. A situation whereby Benjamin Netanyahu will come to the ECOWAS to meet the ECOWAS heads of government. And our president, who is a Christian, refuses to go there and withdraws the Minister of State simply because the Muslim lobby in the country is saying they don't want to have anything to do with Israel. A situation whereby everybody's scared. The situation whereby the Yorubas, 51% of whom supported Buhari in 2015, 49% supported Jonathan, 51% supported Buhari in 2015. Those 51%, that group of people that supported, are now being marginalized and treated with contempt by the very same Buhari that they put in power. And a situation whereby elements that they call the cabal within the government, within the presidency, are not allowing the acting president to be the man he's supposed to be and lead this country, because our president is indisposed. Nobody knows where he is. Nobody knows his condition. We haven't seen or heard from him. And the situation is absolutely abominable. No explanations. And yet you won't let the acting president act as president. A situation whereby for almost 4 months, for almost 6 weeks now, a situation whereby the ministers have been cleared by the Senate. Four ministers, you have not been able to swear them in as acting president. A situation whereby we're halfway through 2017 and you have not been able to sign the budget. I mean, a situation whereby, you know, all these sort of horrific things that are going morning, day and night is unacceptable. A situation whereby you lock up Nnamdi Kanu for so long. Yes, he's free now, but it took you how many years to lock him up? How many years did you lock him up for? Under the most barbaric conditions. A situation whereby you will carry opposition leaders, subject them to criminal investigations that have no basis, prosecute them maliciously for doing absolutely nothing. You carry them, you lock some of them up, as they did with me, in a Boko Haram cell at Kuje prison, the Boko Haram wing, and I was with 47 hardened Boko Haram fighters who consider themselves to be freedom fighters, absolute gentlemen, by the way, because God went ahead of me and they took care of me very well. They didn't kill me, they didn't maim me, as some people had wanted. A situation where you do that, Dasuki is in detention. He's been there for how long now?
How is he responsible for
despite the court orders to release it? El Zak Zaki, you shoot him in the eye. You shoot his wife four times. And you've kept them in detention.
That is why the Southeast IPOP members are agitating that they want to quit.
The reason they have carried out this agitation, and it didn't start today, it became more pronounced 2 years went by, because they knew what Buhari was going to do. And Buhari has marginalized the Southeast. Buhari has treated them with contempt. Buhari has insulted them over and over again in terms of his policies. Buhari has not appointed one Igbo person in the villa, apart from some very, very inconsequential individual who talks rubbish most of the time. I can't even remember her name. There's not one principal not one principal officer in the presidency that is an Igbo person. And you only have two southerners in principal positions in the presidency. I've been in government before. I worked in the presidency in 2003 for three solid years. And every president that came, Obasanjo and post-Obasanjo, apart from Buhari, ensured there was a balance. You understand me? You had people from all over the... This one, there are 90% northern Muslims in the presidency. This is what causes
it. There should be a solution so that we can unite this country again.
As far as I'm concerned, we have crossed the bridge.
Do you think there's no solution?
Let me tell you, the only solution you have now, because we've talked it, I've been in politics for 30 years. I'm not a radical. I'm a moderate, responsible individual that loves Nigeria deeply. But when it has got to a point that even people like me, who all my life have been brought up to get on well with Northerners and people of other faiths, begins to think like this, you will understand that there's a real problem. The truth of the matter is this: unless you restructure Nigeria, devolve power from the center, and allow the regions and the states to have more power and conduct their own affairs, unless you have 100% resource control, let the people that have the oil or whatever manage their own resources and do what they like with it. Okay, unless you have restructuring, this country will break. It's only a matter of time. Now, a situation whereby, I repeat, every single security agency in this country is headed by a northern Muslim, except for the Navy. That tells you something. And Boko Haram is now on the resurgence. The whole Chibok girl thing, the whole mystery behind it, because there are so many questions that haven't been answered. And each time this government has a problem, they suddenly come up with what they call Chibok girls in order to distract attention. We're not fools. And they keep doing it. It's, in fact, somebody actually predicted that they were going to do this on such and such a time, and it came to pass. Okay? We are not fools. And what we are saying is this: we love the country. However, everybody must be treated as equal citizens in this country, regardless of your tribe, your ethnic nationality, your religious faith. The church and Christians must be treated with decency. Stop killing Christians in southern Kaduna. Arrest and prosecute and shoot and hang those that kill our people in southern Kaduna and all across the, what they call the Middle Belt, because the Middle Belt is a very great constituent part of this country. They are not part of Arewa anymore. Yes. There is no single north anymore. You have the core north, which is the far north, northeast and northwest. You have north central, which we call the Middle Belt. These are people with their own history, their own background, their own aspirations, and they should be allowed to be liberated and free from being, you know, murdered and treated as slaves morning, day and night. If you really want Nigeria to continue, recognize these rights. Allow the southerners to also feel as if they are human beings in this country and stop treating us with contempt. This is the baggage that Buhari and his team have brought into this country. And unfortunately, those that assisted him to get to power, that is, the Yoruba 51% that supported him, are also regretting that position now. They have aligned their thoughts with ours. We are in contact. We talk to each other. And what we are saying now is that we're not even talking politics anymore. Amen. It is South and Middle Belt together against those that believe that they were born to rule. And unless they rid themselves of that attitude, I assure you, you know, this country cannot continue the way it is. We must restructure for the sake of
okay, now what is your understanding of restructuring? Because some persons do not really know
what
type of restructuring.
It's a very simple thing. What it is this. You need constitutional reforms in this country. What we have in Nigeria, they call it a federal republic. It's not a federation. Nigeria is a unitary state with a federal facade. All powers are concentrated in the center. The man that sits at the villa just across the road has power over everything touching and concerning your life. He's the most powerful president on this planet in terms of administrative control. He can do literally anything he likes. Nobody ought to live under such bondage. You understand? You need to take some of those powers away from him, from the center, and devolve it to the various regions or states or whatever it is. In other words, you have a weaker center, and then you take the power of governance to the various regions and states. Very much like what we had in the First Republic, although that's a slightly different arrangement, whereby in the Southwest, for example, we had our own flag, we had our own embassies. I'm sure you didn't know that. We had our own everything in the Southwest, our own embassies and so on and so forth.
They came out with one map.
No, but that is for now. But in the First Republic, the country was quite well restructured. But even that wasn't good enough. You asked me the question. Resource control, for example, fiscal federalism.
That's for the South.
For the South, for everybody. In other words, what you have in your backyard should accrue to you. I believe 100%. Some would say, okay, maybe 50. Some will say 90. I believe if you really want peace, let it be 100%. What if it's only sand? You go and develop your sand. Whatever you have, you develop. We did it before. Okay, we did it before in the First Republic, and we did very well in the South. We had cocoa. We didn't have oil. You know, so why not go back to that? You must have that. You must have regional armies. You must have a regional police forces. In other words, I will be policed by my own people, not by some people from an alien foreign land who will come and impose their will on me. The bane of this country is the fact that those that are resisting the whole concept of restructuring, what the reason they're doing it is because they want to maintain control of the center and keep the rest of us in bondage. And what we are saying is that enough is enough. We've been fighting this battle for restructuring ever since June 12th, for many, many years now. And it's very obvious to me that It will not work because the two core northern zones keep on vetoing it. It's a power of veto. And then you look at the whole census issue. You look at the way in which there are more legislators in, I think it's Sokoto State, yes, or Katsina State, yes, than there are in the whole of the southeast put together, simply because you created more local government areas in the northwest than anywhere else. The situation whereby you say Kano has far more people than Lagos State, consequently they have far many more local government areas, and consequently they have far more representation. It means that when you go to the National Assembly, you can't do anything. Because the whole system, as my favorite person, Donald Trump, would say, is rigged. The system is rigged. You know, and that is why people are saying, look, enough is enough. It's not an armed struggle. Nobody is saying carry arms and use arms to secede or kill anybody. No, it's the other side that say that. Nobody on this side is saying that. What they're saying is we have the right of self-determination under international law. And if you are not prepared to make the necessary changes and make us all feel like Nigerians as equals before God in terms of ethnicity and faith, we are opting to leave this man-made artificial creation.
Some people said it's not a good marriage.
What, do you think it's a good marriage? I mean, we were forced into marriage in 1914.
Yeah.
We were described as the rich wife from the south by Lord Lugard. He wrote it. I can show you the transcripts. He described the north as the poor husband. And they merged us. They never asked us if we wanted to be married. They never asked us if we were enjoying the marriage. They refused to allow us to have the option to marry. And after we were married, the rich wife was pillaged, robbed, brutalized, sodomized, cheated, beaten, over and over and over again, until you're not fit to lead. Every single southerner that has become president or head of state in this country has come in as a consequence of the circumstances, not by design, without exception. Every single one of them. It's because certain things happened, and suddenly they had to emerge as a consequence of crisis or as a consequence of somebody died. Every single one. Is that what you call a reason why? Now, even if you say you like this abusive marriage, at least give us the opportunity to voice our views about it. But don't take it for granted. We fought a civil war to keep this country together. Yes, we did. Although my own views, and these are my personal views, was that the Igbos were subjected to genocide. Nothing less than genocide. It's not even just my views, it's a historical fact. Okay? 300 killed on the night of, July 29th, the coup, 300 of their 66. Northern officers who killed 300 Igbo officers. They also slaughtered in the north over 100,000 Igbo civilians. And then we killed, and I say we as Nigerians, slaughtered 3 million Igbos during the course of the Civil War. And not only that, we starved 1 million Igbo children to death. At the end of the war, we gave the Igbos £20 and said, no victor, no vanquished. Mm-hmm. When they went home, they couldn't get all their properties except in the southwest. Everywhere else, the south side and the north, they lost it. They lost everything. We brought them to their knees.
The same core, that's the same thing that is almost happening now.
Well, sadly and unfortunately, because we don't teach history in our schools, nobody wants to know the truth. Everybody runs away from it. But the only country on this planet that does that. And if we had known the truth, we would have been able to learn from it. We won't make the same mistakes again. What is unfolding today is precisely what happened in 1966. Only this time, they're not hiding. They hid it at that time. They hid their disdain for the Igbo. And they hid their plans. This time, they have come out to say, every Igbo person must leave the North by October the 1st. Other than that, if they refuse to do so, certain things will happen. And that is reprehensible.
The elders are denying it, and they are not taking side with that.
The elders are denying it?
Yes.
Then why is it that Alhaji Maitama Sule's PA was sitting there, right next to the man that gave the announcement? Why was he there? Why haven't they been arrested?
Why? You say they're denying it. Who are the elders that are denying it? Maybe Paul Onungo, he's part of the Northern Elders Forum. Yes, there's no question about that. But he's not a core Northerner, so he doesn't speak for them. We know what's going on. He's not happy about it. Southerners are not happy about it. Middle Belters are not. We all want to remain together and live in a decent society where we all love one another. We may have our differences. We may argue about history. But at least this is a modern nation state. But there are some people that don't have that worldview. And when you say they, I want to ask you a question. How did they manage to get Arewa House for that venue? That's a state, that's a state government. That's a revered institution, a revered building. They can't get access to Arewa House unless the Kaduna State government and others gave them permission to do that. How is it that none of them have been arrested up until today? How is it that Professor Angu Abdullahi would get up and say he's in complete agreement with them? Even to the extent that when the Northern Governors Forum said this is not the right thing to do, he reprimanded them. How is it that they have the nerve to sit down and tell their own leaders and elders that they have failed them and that they should stop trying to appease the Igbos and that the Igbos should be brought to heel? This is absolute madness. It is a precursor to genocide. It is a precursor to a civil war. Because if that were to happen, I assure you, not that anybody's planning it, but it's clear from history alone, I don't need to be a prophet to tell you this, if they start killing Igbos in the north, it will not be limited to Igbos. It will be the whole of the south. They'll be killing southerners, and there will be reprisals. And we don't want that. We don't want carnage in this country anymore. And those that are behind these boys, encouraging them, funding them, supporting them, should desist from doing so. And I'm glad that for the first time in our history, you see Yoruba nationalist groups, Yoruba nationalists, Odua People's Congress, OLM, then Afenifere, you know, the revered Afenifere, and you see elders and leaders and nationalist groups from the south standing up and speaking for the Igbos and saying, you dare not kill the Igbos in the north. Because this time around, if you do so, this country will break. That's never happened before. And that's a good thing. That's a good thing that's come out of this whole crisis, is that people from the Middle Belt Youth Forum, SOCAPU, the Southern Kadunas People's Forum, all of them, Afenifere, south, all of them are saying with one voice, leave the Igbos alone. And that gives cause for hope that we are actually coming together in a way now. The people that want to kill us all and believe they own Nigeria are the ones that are on their own this time around. So they should not provoke a war. They should not provoke conflict, because if they do, I assure you they will be worsted. They will not come out of it very easily.
Chief, there's a way we can reach a center point. We need to talk to the youths. How do we do that? How do we change the mindset of Nigerians who are agitating negatively?
Well, you say negatively. I don't think it's negative. I think it's a perfectly natural reaction. If you want people not to react, you don't tell them to remain in bondage forever, indefinitely. You don't do that. Trudeau is the president or prime minister of Canada today. You have Macron in France. He's 39. Trudeau is about 44. You have somebody who's just been elected in Ireland, very young, in his late 30s. You have somebody in Luxembourg in his late 30s. These are by the Niger. You have parliamentarians, seven of them were elected into the House of Commons in the UK just a few days ago. These people in the Nigerian context will be described as youths. They're the same age as those angry youths that talk. They're not youths. These are people, men and women, that have the right to say enough is enough and are saying enough is enough. They have not carried arms, which is a wonderful thing. Rather, they are agitating in a lawful, decent way that we've had enough and we want the right to determine our own future unless Nigeria changes. And it's not just them, the elders. All the groups of elders in the south, Afenifere, Ohaneze, and in the Niger Delta, they're all saying the same thing. Restructure this country or we're going to have major problems in the future. So we're all together on this. The south is together on this. The middle belt is with us on this. It's only one group whose elders are saying no and that we should go to hell. And the other group, who are below them, that is the northern youths, who are now threatening to kill Igbo people and southerners unless they leave by October the 1st. And we're here. We're not going anywhere. Let's see what will happen.
Now, let's go back to the June 12. We'll look at the gains. What level of gains has June 12 and the events around it given to Nigeria since 1993?
Had it not been for June 12, it is my view that we wouldn't have democracy in Nigeria today. And if we didn't have, it would either be military rule or the country would have broken up. Because like I said earlier, what happened in June 12th, the reaction to what they did to Abiola and his family, that is they killed them, they locked them up, and so many of his supporters, was that eventually, if Abacha had succeeded himself, the South would have made an attempt to secede. And there would have been a war that would have gone on for at least 50 years in the West African sub-region. So June 12th was very significant. But it was a triumph, because that's what I choose to remember. It was a triumph for democracy. And unfortunately, certain forces aborted that triumph, killed those that were triumphant, and set in motion and in place their own agenda and their own their own dream and their own vision, which is what we have up until today, which I think in many ways is a monumental tragedy. But at least we have democracy. At least we can talk. At least we can express ourselves and express our views. At least that is up until 2 years ago, because now
with this new regime in place, when PDP was in power, nobody was ever arrested for expressing their views. You're a journalist. Nobody. If the worst we would do is to respond to you or respond to anybody. But now it's become a very dangerous thing to express your views in this country. Political detainees all over the place. Opposition is being decimated and being humiliated and marginalized and also maligned. And demonized. And you have a government which came to power by propaganda, which is sustaining itself by propaganda, and which has nothing but propaganda. They have drained our country. They have destroyed our economy. We're in a recession. They have devalued our naira. They have caused us to be a pariah in the international community once again. Nobody cares about us anymore. We've been humiliated and we are divided, and something needs to be done. And by God's grace, by 2019, they will be out of power.
If you are opportunity to be in power, will you declare public holiday for June 12th?
Without a doubt. Be the first thing I'd do.
As president of this country, the first thing I'd do is declare June 12th as not just a public holiday. I would change the whole thing. I say that is Democracy Day, because that's really what it is. And that's why I'm glad that the Southwest, even if others have forgotten, the Southwestern states have not forgotten, and that's why they've declared, all of them to the last man, all our states in the Southwest have declared June 12th as a public holiday. I'm very pleased about that.
Thank you very much.
It's my pleasure.
Thank you very much for watching. We've been talking with Chief Fani Kayode, and he has been able to explain the rationale behind the June 12th, the Abiola and the death of Abiola, and also look into national issues, agitations from different regions in Nigeria, and even talking about a restructuring of the Nigerian economy and political state. This is where we'll draw the curtains close on this program today. Do join us same time for another very interesting package. I am Ijoma Osamu.
Welcome to Fosville Luxury Hotel. At Fosville Luxury Hotel, we offer excellent service. Our rooms have all the necessary facilities to make your stay comfortable and memorable. You will also have access to internet service, breakfast, 24-hour power supply, full air condition, free international calls, free tire pumping service, and free car battery charge. So what are you waiting for? Quickly visit Fosville Luxury Hotel. We are located as number 1 Adeniran Bamishile off Raja Rasaki Road, First Estate, Amuwo, Ojofife, Stark, Lagos. For more information or reservation, please call us on 080-75-78-7135 or 080-99-90-0601. You can also take advantage of our online ongoing promo at www.fosvhotel.com to make your reservation and payment for your favorite room, which attracts a discount rate. Please note, rooms are reserved based on first come, first serve. Fosvhotel, experience the home of comfort. They come.